Now, this is a very fun section. I have to tell you, I really like cardiac and I really like anatomy. I like terminology and I like the physiology of the disease process and stuff. That's why I like ICD-9 and ICD-10. It's what I do. So, there have been several requests coming in for some help with cardiac coding. And I think that, you know, it's not as hard as some people think it is once you get in and start doing it. Yes, there is some complex guidelines, but they're not that hard. I don't even want to say they're complex. They're not. It's just that they're detailed. So you have to know the terminology. And if you know the terminology and you understand the anatomy, it's not bad at all. And there's people who are cardiac coders that think it's not hard because it's what they do every day. However, somebody just stepping in, they struggle. So what I decided to do is give you some basics of cardiac knowledge that you need to start with. If you get this stuff down, then it's going to make cardiology coding a lot easier. And again, this is basic, and then you can get into advanced. But it is a lot of information, so I had to divide it up into two slides. And the first thing was that not all arteries and veins have separate entries in the alphabetic index. That's why you need to kind of know what's going on for the anatomy and the terminology. As a coder, you need to know the anatomy of the heart and the circulation process. Now, if you had biology or anatomy in high school or maybe college, you may know some of this basic stuff, but you need to expand on it just a little bit more as a coder. So let's start with the heart. Okay, what's the first step in cardiology coding? You need to know your anatomy of the heart. One of the things that's so impressive about the heart is that it's considered one of the strongest organs in the body. And it's made up of involuntary muscle. And if you studied muscle, the structure of muscles and muscle tissue, there's different type. There's cardiac muscle, there's like striated muscle and smooth muscle and all this other stuff. And there's voluntary and involuntary muscle. Involuntary muscle means that you don't have to think about moving it. So if I say, oh, I do this, I'm using my muscles, but I have to think about doing it, it doesn't do it on its own. Unlike your heart, I don't have to think about telling my heart to beat, it does it on its own. Okay, that's involuntary. Then another thing that people don't realize is that your heart pumps an average of 4,000 gallons of blood a day in the adult body. 4,000 gallons. You know, so it is, you think about how many gallons of water is in your swimming pool, if you're lucky enough to have a swimming pool. So, let's talk a little more in depth. Systemic circulation delivers the blood to the body cells and carries the waste away. Simple as that. That's what it does. Pulmonary circulation eliminates the carbon dioxide and oxygenates the blood through the lungs. So when we exhale, it pulls the carbon dioxide, our carbon dioxide goes away, and you inhale and your lungs oxygenates the blood and it goes through the same way again and again. And plants like carbon dioxide, so it's good to talk to your plants, and plants release oxygen, so it's also good to talk to your plants. You're not weird if you do that. So arteries carry blood away from the heart and veins return blood to the heart. The arteries carry oxygenated blood, so that's why it's usually indicated in red in diagrams and stuff. And veins return the deoxygenated blood to the heart, and it's usually seen as blue in diagrams. So what size is the heart? Well, your heart is usually the size of your fist. So if you're a child, that's how big your heart is. If you're an adult, this is how big your heart is, usually. Now, these are some terms you need to know. And I'm going to tell you definitely you need to know what these are. If you don't, memorize them. Simple as that. And I'm very good about telling you, you don't need to really know that because you can access it. But in this case, you need to know. So pericardium encloses the heart. It's like a bag. It's like this little sack. Okay, is around the heart, and it's visceral, and it's slick. Keeps the heart protected. The pericardial cavity contains the fluid for the heart to float in. So you have the pericardium, this little bag that the heart's in, and then there's fluid between that and the heart. So the pericardium is very important, and the pericardial cavity is important. Keep in mind, you've heard of pericarditis and stuff like that. That's when that's inflamed, you know, or there's an infection in the cavity of the heart, you know, you don't want anything to happen to that. Now, the wall of the heart, you need to know these. The epicardium is the outer layer of the heart, and that reduces the friction. It's all nice and slick. The myocardium is the middle layer, mostly cardiac muscle. Myo stands for muscle, okay? The endocardium is the inner layer of the heart, and the blood vessels, and I can't pronounce that word, it's parenchy fibers or whatever. So epicardium, outer layer of the heart, myocardium, the middle layer or the muscle part of the heart, and the endocardium, the inner layer of the heart. Know those. Pericardium, pericardial cavity, epicardium, myocardium, and endocardium. Okay, so let's talk about the heart a little bit more here, and the basic structure of the inside of the heart. One of the, you know how there's always the exceptions in the American language, excuse me, in the English language, and they'll say, you know, I before C, I before E, except after C, and the exception of, you know, like receive and some of those others. Well, that's the case with the heart. Arteries carry oxygenated blood, veins carry deoxygenated blood, except in this one artery called a pulmonary artery, and this one vein called a pulmonary vein. So let's talk about the structure. The superior vena cava, and superior means above, the superior vena cava brings blood, deoxygenated blood, from the upper half of the body into the heart. And then down here, the inferior or below vena cava bring the deoxygenated blood from the lower part of the body into the heart. And what it does is it goes into the right atrium. Okay, and you've got four chambers in a human heart. So it goes into the right atrium. When the right atrium is full of blood, it whooshes down into the right ventricle. The atriums are on top, the ventricles are on the bottom. If you have trouble remembering that, think of this little V, this little apex of the heart looks like a V. So the ventricles, the Vs are on the bottom, and the atriums are on the top. And isn't an atrium, you know, the outer, upper, you know, think of attic, atrium. Okay, so when the right atrium fills up, it whooshes through the tricuspid valve. And that tricuspid valve makes sure that the blood, once it gets in the right ventricular cavity, doesn't go whooshing back up into the atrium, because that would be bad if it regurgitates back up there. So once the right atrium fills up and it gets completely full, it whooshes up the pulmonary artery. And the pulmonary artery is shaped like a T, because it's going to, you know, if you've ever, my husband was a plumber for a long time. So a T fitting is literally, you know, like that. So it whooshes up and it goes out to each side of the chest, to the right and left heart, lung. Even though this is an artery, it is the only artery that carries deoxygenated blood. So it's going to whoosh in and go out to the lungs, where it's going to exchange the waste or the carbon dioxide and pick up oxygen. And when it comes back to the heart from the lungs, it's going to go through the pulmonary vein. So the pulmonary vein is the only vein that carries oxygenated blood, because the rest of them carry deoxygenated blood. Now, if I was going to write a test question, I would throw that in there and figure out a way to confuse you to see if you got that concept down. So the pulmonary veins come in from the left and the right from the heart, the lung, and it gets forced into the left atrium. Now, this is oxygenated blood. So this goes through the mitral valve, or it's also could be called the bicuspid valve. Mitral and bicuspid, and I don't remember why they use both those terms. Some people say mitral, some will say bicuspid. But it whooshes down into the left atrium. When the left atrium is completely full of blood, the heart will contract and it whooshes up into the aorta. Now, the aorta is got three exit points here, and these exit points are really cool. You'll always recognize the aorta because it's got those three little tubes, looks like a bagpipe thing. But this one over here on the left goes out to the left side of the body. This one goes up into the head, and the other one goes out to the other side of the body and then whooshes on down, and then the whole process starts again. Now, this is a basic, very basic concept for the heart. Oh, I forgot to tell you about the pulmonary valve and the aortic valve. Okay, so you have four valves in your heart. You have four chambers of your heart. You have a pulmonary artery that doesn't carry oxygenated blood, and you have a pulmonary vein that does carry oxygenated blood, which is in contrast. Okay, you need to know those. You need to memorize those. Okay. Next. Now, this is more detailed, but it's important to know the outside of the heart, because when a person has cardiac issues like a heart attack and stuff like that, that's affecting these outside vessels. Now, you don't have to know all of these. Again, you've got your aorta and all of these little bagpipe parts that I like to call bagpipe parts. They have names and stuff. You don't necessarily need to know that. What you do need to know is that this is the apex of the heart, that little V shape, and you need to understand these veins. You do not have to have these veins memorized. You can't. There's too many of them. But if you're going to have to code for bypasses and stuff like that, these are the veins and arteries they're talking about and the ones they're going to bypass. So when you hear them say, well, I had a four-way bypass, that means they took four of these veins and bypassed them with other veins that they or arteries that they pulled from someplace else in the body, usually the leg. Okay, so this is the outside of the heart. And again, most of this, you know, you're going to these terms, not necessarily you have to have memorized, okay? But I would know that this is the apex of the heart, and that those veins all around the when there's death of tissue, if there's a blockage right here, then this tissue dies, and that's why they bypass it with other veins, okay? And cardiac tissue does not come back once it's dead, okay? Let's see. So here is a view. Now this is an anterior view. This is a posterior view, and it's important to kind of know both of them. These, again, you do not have to have these memorized, but you need to be aware of them, like coronary sinus. Okay. Let's see. Middle cardiac vein. You know, again, you don't have to have that memorized, but if you see that in documentation, you're going to think, oh, okay, I kind of remember. That's up in the heart, okay? But I wanted you to see what this looks like, because you want to be aware of this. Now, that's all for those slides, but this, memorize. These, be aware of them. It would be great if you could label them. And there's things out there on Google that you can use to practice labeling them.
Get more CPC exam tips, coding certification training, and CEU credits. Go to www.codingcertification.org.